Hello, friends. So one of the most popular questions I get at real estate events, you know, you're on stage and, you know, you start taking questions at the end. The most frequent question I get is a version of this one is, what would you do if you knew what you knew now, but you had to start over? So, you know, I think about that, you know, quite regularly because I get asked it a lot. And I think there's kind of five things. You know, most of them I document in this book. But when I kind of sit down and go, okay, you know, if I was seriously looking at doing this, what would I flip flop or change? So I kind of break it down like this, right? The first one is I would appreciate live where you want and invest where the numbers make sense. And what I mean by that is, as I highlight in the book, we wasted a full year, you know, ultimately landing on a market that made sense, right? We live in the Bay Area. And, you know, as a rental area, the Bay Area really has never made sense, at least if you have the small, you know, down payments that we had saved up. So, you know, I could have saved a year. We would have been buying very early in a seller's market, which would have meant we would have had extreme profit for the next 5 or 6 years as far as equity growth. So that's the first thing I would do. You know, so I would get to my market faster. The second thing I would do, again, leveraging what I know now, if I had to start over, was I would certainly watch the affordability index. Again, I talk about it in the book. It's something that we kind of lucked into, and it saved us right at the peak, right? We could have lost, I don't know, upwards of $1 million in net worth if we didn't, you know, sort of have the affordability index smack us in the face and go, you know, time to move some equity around. Which we did via 1031 exchanges and got out of the overpriced houses and went to apartments. So I could have watched that earlier. We got really lucky getting out of the last one right before it really rolled over. I think it actually had rolled over, but still closed. So that's certainly one. I would have, well, we should have been getting out probably a year earlier than we did because it was kind of sketchy there near the end. The other one I would do is I would go to private money faster. So as I talk about in the book, when the market rolled over, we were still kind of naive and thought that we could just get any loan we wanted. And nothing could be further from the truth for probably at least 8 years, if not 10. But we didn't know at the point, right? It just rolled over. So we were starting to see deals in the MLS, like literally in the MLS, right? Buy here, any price, you know, make an offer, that kind of stuff. And we didn't know any better, so we found a hard money lender that saved us a lot. And what I mean by saved us is it meant we could keep buying. But, you know, it was expensive, still pretty decent down payment. And, you know, we could have bought more if we went to private money earlier. So that'd be nice because, again, private money is not necessarily much cheaper. In fact, we paid a percent higher on private money, but it was interest only. So the payment was roughly the same. And there was no points and fees and, you know, payoff periods and all of that. So I'd have gone to private money faster. Then I would have networked more. One of the things that I was kind of limited by was I was all over the world. And, you know, I was often doing my work or research in hotel rooms and you know, early in the morning. So I would have, I should have networked more. And if I couldn't network at local meetups, I should have done a better job of virtually networking and using my phone skills and airport times to introduce myself to more people. You know, my network really didn't explode till the last 5 years or so. So that's something. And then the last one was I would have gotten a I don't know if it's called a coach or a mentor or something like that. You know, it was tough, right? I at least felt like in the beginning I was recreating the wheel, which just isn't true, right? I'm sure if I would have looked hard enough, I could have found somebody that was a full-time employee that ultimately retired or left because of rentals. I didn't look, so I didn't find. And I think, you know, I don't know if that would have helped us go faster or, you know, better or anything like that, but it would have made me feel better for sure, right? Because somebody had been down there and said, oh yeah, evictions are terrible. Yeah, roof leaks. And yeah, stoves going out on Christmas. And yeah, yeah. I mean, they would be able to commiserate with you. That would have probably would have been a lot less stressful, right? So those are the five things I would have done. Again, I talk about, you know, each of those kind of in the book, kind of where they kind of stay relevant in the phases. I bring up the coach one, a little self-serving, I guess. But again, I'm trying to be that voice now, right? That full-time employee who did it. And all I'm trying to do is reach down and help the people that want to do it themselves. So if you do want to, you know, if you work full-time and you have just little slivers of time, that's why I developed that $99 course. It's not meant to make me rich or anything silly like that. It is meant to be, this is how we started. It's meant to have a dollar amount so that you actually do something. I've played with free and it doesn't work. So there's a little skin in the game. And I think if you do it, and then what I've done when I organized the course is I moved a specific piece of work to step one. I didn't want to get into a course and have the first 60 minutes just be fluff. We jump in and we do something, which for me is going to tell me if you're going to do anything or if you're just going to waste the $100, right? So I think the first section you could watch in a weekend, right? Get up early Saturday, get up early Sunday, or stay up late Saturday, stay up late Sunday, turn off Netflix, whatever it is, and just watch it. If you really want to learn buy and hold rental properties, you should listen to a guy that's done it. I mean, I'm not trying to be arrogant. I'm just trying to be matter of fact. And I give you the exact plan, the exact homework, how it was done. So in the end, I think having a coach either, you know, help you go faster or help you start well, right? That first deal is good, is pretty helpful. So, you know, at the end of the day, that's what I would do if I was starting over. Have a great day.